I'd like to call the meeting to order. This is the Governing Board Workshop, Friday, June 10th, 2022. And I'd like to ask that after we've called this meeting to order, that we stand, if you're able, and say the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We do have a quorum with 8 members in person and with the 9th person online. So we are all in attendance. The first thing on the agenda is the approval of the special meeting amended minutes from May 11th, 2022. If you remember last meeting, there was a concern that the meeting minutes had not been shared with the secretary, and then we found that indeed they had been, but it's nice to know that someone that is young can have a little forgetfulness as well. So now we're up and running, and Lisa has made some changes to the minutes, and so those minutes are in your possession, and are there concerns? Lisa.
Thank you, President Fitzsimons. It wasn't that I hadn't seen the minutes. It was the fact that I wasn't the one who approved them. It was just that you were the one that approved them. I didn't approve them. That was my issue.
Okay.
So thank you.
Understood. Okay.
Thank you.
So we have some changes. Any concern with the amended changes? Okay, they will stand approved as written. And we'd also like to approve the May 13th Governing Board Workshop minutes from our regular workshop. Were there any corrections, changes to those minutes? Okay, seeing none, then those will be approved as written as well. Okay, the first thing on the agenda for our meeting today is to have our general manager kind of talk with us about the status of the clubs. If you remember, way back a year ago, about a year ago, we had tax concerns that came to light with our different clubs, and we had to make some changes, and the operations side of our organization were tasked with working with the clubs to adjust things that needed to be done. We ended up with a Del Sol Gallery at Pora. We ended up redoing of the RRPs to align things. And so here we are a year later, and this is the report that identifies what changes have been made. And I'll turn this over to Bill.
Thank you, Ms. Fitzsimons and Governing Board and all of you in attendance today. Thank you for being here. Before I get started, I would like to do a little bit of a shout out to a couple of people who are not here today. Donna Maloney, I know she is present on some kind of audio reception. So Donna, if you're hearing me, a big thanks to you for all of the work that you put into the reorganization of the RRMPs, as well as Casey Huta, who is she's not here this weekend. She had a vacation scheduled with her children and playing in a tournament out of state. So she is not here today, but a big shout out to her taking this program over, in addition to all the special event activities that she does so well and plans. Looking over the charter club amenities that we do have has now fallen in her lap, and she, as well as Donna, put a lot of work into this, getting us to this point, and what a difference a year makes. So we are, I believe, back on the rails, and any and all club members who are here that kind of helped with the committees and all of the work that we've done through this learning process of the world of the IRS and taxation and classifications of various types of clubs and organizations. My hats off to all of you. And I would just like to give you a little bit of a presentation this morning regarding where we are, which is a very, very good spot. So when it comes to chartered clubs, obviously, there are certain qualifications and standards that apply, right? And so those are kind of drafted and crafted within the rec center policies, as well as the newly authored rules, regulations, and procedures. That was a major cleanup. It reads very, very well now, very easily to understand, and they're very well synced with the clubs that are in existence today, and they're very much synced with our policies. So that is, that was a huge undertaking. So with that, there's a couple of things that, that do apply when it comes to rules and regulations. So non-craft clubs, to start a club up and to maintain a club, we're looking at about 75 valid paid members to maintain this club and to get a club started. Craft clubs yes. require a minimum of 50 people as far as paid up members. So with that, there were some conflicts within the RRMPs. So in 2022, updated rules, regulations, and procedures were approved by Charter Club Committee, and it went to the Governing Board for approval, and that has happened. The majority of the conflicts that were there were dealing with outside guests, active participation of club members, and the total club membership numbers. Those are things we're kind of still working with, but I think we're at a very, very good spot moving forward. So a little bit of a summary. Dating back to 2016, the Rec Centers of Sun City West had 111 chartered clubs. As of today, we're sitting at 97. So of the 14 clubs difference, six out of the 14 have simply merged with other clubs that are kind of doing the same type of activity, and they continue their hobbies. Two of the 14 have become not-for-profit organizations and continue their hobbies as well. One dropped their charter, but continues via contract to work with us and partnered regarding their services and what they do for the association. And five groups of the 14 have completely dissolved. Those that did dissolve since 2016 were the Organ and Keyboard Club, a card playing group, a Latin ballroom, Western square dance, and men's billiards. Primarily lack of participation, both of those participating in the club activity and kind of a lack of enthusiasm, shall we say, as far as filling the required board seats, president, vice president, secretary, treasurer, not really people involved enough to want to get involved and provide that service. So they've dissolved. But those activities still take place within the walls of Sun City West, just not as chartered clubs. Other clubs have merged, like we talked about. So a golf club, the Stardust Ladies Niners, have joined simply with the Stardust Women's 18 group. A coin and stamp club joined with the investment club. Dancing Arts joined with the Rhythm Tappers, and they're now called the Dance Sensations. And three card playing groups have joined with a group that are club that is now called the Card Players of Sun City West. So categorically, here's where we sit as far as our clubs go. Arts and crafts are your number one collection of clubs, followed by number two with all of the golf clubs that we have spread out throughout the seven golf courses that we have. And that's how we have these things classified. So breaking them down, arts and crafts, we have card playing clubs, fitness and dance, hobbies, social clubs, golf, performing arts, and sports. How those numbers lay out look like this. So again, arts and crafts at the top of the list, and we have 9 card playing clubs, 12 sports clubs, social clubs, performing arts, and that, getting us to the 97 total clubs that we currently have. We are a built out community, right? And so space is a premium. So shared and dedicated space is absolutely something that we look for and what the clubs expect to have. So when it comes to dedicated space, obviously outdoor sports clubs, hard court surfaces are difficult to do many activities on other than what they're entitled to do, right? Tennis clubs, tennis courts, pickleball, softball, those types of things. Arts and crafts rooms, whether it's the wood shop here, that's a very nice picture of you, Mr. Sloan, by the way. Arts and crafts clubs, very difficult to do multi-events in those rooms simply because of all the equipment that they've gotten in them, be it auto restoration, be it metal shop, those types of things. Agriculture the same way. So 59% of all those clubs that we talked about earlier share spaces. So it's a challenge and it's a scheduling nightmare, but we get through it. So when it comes to the IRS and where we were, right, we currently have 91 clubs now back on track. All clubs are actually back on track, but the social clubs, primarily the arts and crafts venues, were the ones that were getting a little out of line with what social clubs really are as far as their tax classifications and 501c7. Other clubs are 501c3s, which are charitable organizations. several clubs within the C7s are still looking into potentially moving over into the 501c3 category, which is great because that's a triple win. If you're continuing your hobby and you continue to do what you do and raise money and then contribute back into the community to other nonprofit agencies, that's wonderful, man. That's a win-win-win. But the social clubs are now doing, are aligned and doing what they're intended to do, and that is social function. So how are these clubs, regarding social clubs, funded? And this is really as simple as we can knock it down, is the social clubs are funded strictly by their members, not the members of the entire community, but the members of the club. So by definition, these social clubs primarily raise their money by dues, fees, and charges paid by their club members. And the IRS basically has a stipulation there that they may not receive up to 35% of its gross receipts from outside sources other than dues, fees, charges, and other funds paid by club members. And of that 35%, 15% of that gross receipts should come from the use of the social club's facilities or serve, should not come from the general public. And so, again, these clubs are independent agencies, and they basically have legal and tax status capabilities that they're responsible for. So to retain the social club status, they've got rules to follow. If they would like to convert to a charitable tax status of 501c3, they are very able to do that if they qualify and they are charitable organizations. But as we sit today, the 91 clubs that are social clubs are absolutely doing perfectly. So others can convert to a nonprofit organization, and we have a couple that we can go into a little detail on, or they can dissolve their charter and still continue to do what they do, just not as a chartered club status. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the not-for-profit organization, and they don't earn profit for its owners, and these are organizations that are required to operate for the benefit, not required to operate for the public good. So there's a couple here that I'd like to talk about. One is Kiva Bridge. Currently, they're playing cards 4 days a week, and they average about 80 players a day. Of that, 49% of those players are non-resident. That was the issue initially with the IRS. They are bringing in outside monies and falling out of that 15% requirement that the IRS basically presents when you're talking about a 501c7 club. Hillcrest Dance was the same way. They were dwindling in participation numbers locally, but they still want to dance. They're currently dancing 2 days a month, but over 75% of those participants are non-residents. These folks basically have a contract with us. They pay rent to use the facilities that they do. They are paying rent, but the owner members of the club that live here are entitled to rent those facilities contractually as a club, and basically they can then invite anyone that they like into these facilities. So it's a way around the chartered club scenario that basically accommodates them to provide their recreational need. Friends of the Library is a 501c3 group that no longer is a chartered club, but they are still a very productive organization within Sun City West. They are, again, 501c3. They provide annual funding and support for the R.H. Johnson Library. But when the RRMPs are drafted, they have to have so many meetings, they have to have, you know, so much member participation, and they, quite frankly, they don't. They have a lot of membership, a lot of people contribute to the 501c3 and donate money and donate books and those types of things. That's all great, but they just don't fall within the rules and regulations, per se, as how they're penciled out. So it's not a very big deal. They just simply are not a chartered club, but they continue to do exactly what they were doing under a 501c3 arrangement and a contract. So this is not finished, so we are still dealing with a little bit of work in progress. The Broadcast Club is one, very, very similar to what I just said about the Friends of the Library. They too have a limited membership as far as that goes, when it hits the 75 or the 50 numbers as far as what it takes to be a chartered club. They're light there, but again, they provide a tremendous public service to this community. So it's not like we want them to go away. It's just that the way the RRMPs are written, they don't really fall underneath that umbrella too well. And so via either amendments to the RRMP or a contractual agreement like we have with the Friends of the Library is a way to resolve this problem, and we are in the process of working with the Broadcast Club to move that one forward. Reciprocal agreements have been going on here for at least 20 years. The research that we've gone through and kind of look at, going back to a general manager named Wyckoff, I believe back in 2000, basically said no. The facilities here are for owner members. And over time, that has changed. I don't know where, I don't know how, but looking at the paper trail, various things have happened. And we'll talk particularly right now about softball, because that is just something that we are currently working on. And when people get back from vacation and that kind of thing, more public meetings will evolve and that kind of thing. But we've gotten some complaints and comments from softball players, residents who live here that enjoy our softball field and would like to play softball. When they join the softball club, they try out, and based on their age and ability, they get placed on teams in various types of skill categories. They're called American League, National League, whatever leagues they call them, and they play. Excuse me? Okay, thank you. But complaints have come in, and you know, they make a tremendous amount of sense. I am an owner here in Sun City West. I'd like to play softball. Yet when I join this particular club, I've got put on a team, and I play all my games in Sun City. I don't want to play in Sun City. I want to play here. That's why I joined here. But there's a reciprocal agreement that allows Sun City teams and players to come to Sun City West and play, and Sun City West players to go to Sun City and play. It's not team for team. It's just 600 players in Sun City West and 200 in Sun City form all of these teams, and then they go travel around back and forth within Sun City and Sun City West. We asked Sun City for a reciprocal agreement, and they looked at us with kind of cross-eyed and like, what are you talking about? And so going back 20 years, it's really depending on who's the president of the club to determine these kind of arrangements. And that thing has kind of transcended into pickleball and tennis and lawn bowling and those types of things, where we're told there are reciprocal agreements, but we just seemingly, they haven't shown up on our desks yet to read. So it's a philosophical problem. It's a policy issue. I mean, is that what we're about? I mean, the more play you put on facilities, the more wear and tear you put on facilities, and we are the ones replacing those facilities. And if outside people are coming in, putting in that extra wear and tear on those and not paying 10 cents to do it, not sure on the fairness on that. So again, back to club committee, back with these particular clubs and groups to see how they're dealing with reciprocal play. And the same thing with some of the card clubs as well. Again, work in progress. So we also look at dedicated space. There are clubs like the Boomers who have far outgrown the facility that they've got as far as their space in Koontz. And where do we put them? Do we build extra facilities? Do we look at the most efficient use of the spaces that we do have? And where can they continue their recreational needs efficiently, and how do we take care of that? We look at, again, the efficiencies of our venues. Club contributions are looked at. Several clubs want to rearrange the interior of their clubs. They want to build shelving. They do that. And some clubs have the financial ways through the means that they do collect fees and that type of thing to help offset costs, which is great. And then we look at rental rates as well, as far as on an annual basis, with the governing board approves what we do as far as those types of things. And then back to the library and the radio scenario, we deal with contracts and how we're moving forward with those. So the revised and adopted RMPs. Our staff are meeting individually with every club, revising their chartered club bylaws to make sure that they're fully understanding of where they're at and what is required. And we're getting, I think, tremendous amount of positive feedback as these clubs come in and meet with staff and kind of keep this train now back on the rails doing the right thing. So again, that concludes my presentation, and this is the classification of clubs, and I'd be happy to answer any questions if you have any.
Board members? Roberta?
Well, my only complaint, always my two cents, I get a little irked, Bill. You keep going around and saying the governing board approved the fees. We have never approved the fees for the clubs. It was put in as part of the RRNPs, but that specific document and the individual fees were never approved by the governing board.
Yeah. So we're hearing here, it is in the budget and it was part of the RRNPs.
But the individual fees were never discussed or voted on by the governing board.
Right.
And it sort of bothers me that we're running around saying, oh, the governing board approved these fees when we didn't.
You're speaking of, excuse me.
Jim, did you want to say something?
You're speaking of the Kiva Bridge type situation that have now a contract with us?
No, I'm talking about if you want to rent a room, if you want to have an ice chest, if you want to have different extra trash cans, if you want, yeah, the charter club's fees. This was never voted on by the governing board. The individual fees.
Ann?
Isn't that part of the RRNPs?
No, it was added to the RRNPs as an addendum. It was not voted on.
Madam President, this is Donna. May I say something?
Yes, go ahead, Donna.
Thank you, Madam President. I would just like to say that the fees charged for equipment, that's part of operations. The governing board has never had input, to the best of my knowledge, regarding charging if I want to, you know, as a club, use the popcorn machine, get a coffee pot, any of that. That's all part of operations.
Correct. That's why I said I don't like people running around and saying that the governing board approved those fees. That is part of operations, and that should not be said that the governing board approved them.
Okay. Tim?
Those have been presented to the board. Casey stood up here one day and showed us the list. And in fact, one of the questions I asked her, is this a new list? And she said, no, it's not a new list. It's just been upgraded and published. So we have seen those, and they are part of the budget, and the board did approve them.
No, we didn't.
Yes, we did. When you approve the budget, you approve everything in the budget. You approve a budget. It includes a lot of different things. When you approve the budget, you approve it all.
Okay, so I think you're, Jim, something else?
Something, new topic?
Yes.
Same topic. I'd like to know how the rent was arrived at for Kiva Bridge, for example, would be, is that normal? Is that the rates that the board has approved and they're paying whatever the number is a month?
Yes, sir. Regarding the card room over there in our rental,
yes,
rate,
Beardsley.
I believe it's for a 4 or 5 hour block. I believe it's a $50 rate for a resident rate. And so based on that and based on the number of hours that they're utilizing that room over a monthly period, I believe it's $900.
So there's an agreement between you and Kiva Bridge, between the general manager and Kiva Bridge, to continue that for a year.
Yes, sir.
So you only have the power to do 1 year. So
that is correct.
So they're at the mercy of next year.
They have the option of presenting to the Charter Club Committee for a recommendation to the governing board. Governing board can approve a three-year term. I am limited to one.
That's never been presented at all or discussed, has it?
No. And that's up to the Kiva Bridge Association to do that. I know they're interested in doing so.
Yeah.
And it's just a matter of moving forward.
Can you go back to the broadcast club for a minute, please?
Mm-hmm.
I don't see a value in eliminating them as a charter club, and I'll tell you why. The FCC license is held by the rec center, not by the club. So if we take away their charter, albeit they can't, they will never make the numbers that we have in RRMP. So there's a conundrum here. We've got a problem. We've got to fix the problem. How do we fix it? And your solution of altering the RRMPs, why couldn't this group just say that we have an exemption for the broadcast club in this situation, and we will exempt them from those rules that apply to everybody else? Why couldn't that happen?
There's nothing preventing that, sir.
I think so too. I would like to move that. I would like to present that as an option to be voted on in June meeting if that's approved by their club.
I believe that was one of the two options that was presented to the club. Mm-hmm. And I think that this isn't resolved yet because they were, reorganizing their leadership. And so that's why this is still under consideration. But I believe that they were given a number of choices, and that was one of them that was included that would have to then come back to us too. Well, to approve that.
The only information I have is from a past president who is not the president anymore, but quit because of this is going on. And his thought was that they're scared to death. The board was scared to death. The membership scared to death of a contract because of the finality of it in a year. So we're talking about people that don't like change unless it's my idea and that sort of thing happening here. And so it seems to me that if we could give them stability and some hope that not next year it's not going to change, that you're not going to come in and charge them rent when they don't have any money to pay. They're a 501c3, so to pay rent doesn't make any sense to these guys.
Right. So. It was brought up, I believe, a meeting ago, contractually for $1 a year contracts. But again, the other option was presented that we put an asterisk or some kind of something in the RRMPs that basically call them out as a service provider to the organization, and they can keep the charter if the governing board views it that way.
How do we decide it at a dollar a year? How did that? Tim Hurley did that. You know how he is.
Right. Those are just options that are on the table.
Yeah, there are options, I know, but I think that it needs to be a discussion. This group needs to make that decision because these are our neighbors that we're talking about. These are folks, and I appreciate the fact that the work that you're providing here, but this is something that needs to be discussed as is this club worth having? Is it worth keeping? And if so, what do we do? How do we do with this problem?
No one's saying no. It's just work in progress.
Okay, it's up to the club leadership. If that's the choice that they would like us to pursue, yes, then it would come back to us to then approve that. If they have a different option that they choose, it's really their decision. Lisa?
Thank you, President Fitzsimons. I wanted to say, Bill, thank you. Great presentation. Appreciate that. Second, the first question I have is in regards to this one slide, so it's not up there, but it said at the bottom of the Sun City West Broadcast Club, mm-hmm. contractual agreement or modification of RRMPs. And when we were doing that, Casey was very adamant that we would only be doing revisions or modifications in September every year to the RRMPs. Are we going to hold true to that, or would we be trying to do a special modification prior to, or just try and stick to that, bring this up in September?
Well, I think Casey was leaning at that time was the fact that I think that was the next, I believe, scheduled time the governing board's getting together.
Great.
So that was kind of circled there on that calendar. If you wanted to do it earlier than that, special meeting or something along those lines can certainly happen.
Okay, great, thanks. And the other question I have is, goes along what kind of like what Jim was asking about Kiva Bridge, but I'm a little curious about the Hillcrest Dance Club. What do they pay for the room rental per night? Do you know?
No, offhand, I don't.
No?
I'm sorry.
Oh, okay, that's okay. I was just curious because I was trying to see if it kind of balanced out.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's whatever's on that rental fee for them.
So they kind of go along the same lines of following the rental sheet?
Yes, ma'am.
Super. Thank you so much.
Sharon?
Thank you, President Fitzsimons. I've asked this before, and I think a number of members have. there's policies that we have not set up yet in regards to a lot of these different pieces. There's something called being a subsidiary of the clubs, which is underneath that. There's part of the whether or not you become an unchartered club, what happens to you. For example, the state clubs right now are in our rec center newspaper, but ENEA, and they're non-chartered. However, the other unchartered clubs are not in there anymore. So what examples, and they're not allowed to come to social events. So we need to at least have the discussion more about what we can and can't put in, who we want to have, what's the cost analysis of bringing somebody underneath us versus having them be a 501c3 or 4 or 7 or whatever they have. And we haven't had that discussion. So it, as a board, I ask about it for a workshop. I still think we need to have it as a workshop because the broadcast club falls under this now. We're going to make, if we make a special arrangements with them, and I have nothing wrong with the broadcast club being a public service group, but you might have others that are going to fall under that. So what's the criteria we look for when we look at somebody who's going to be separate with a separate policy? What does it look like for the policies that we write? And then we hand it off to Bill and to the general manager and say specifically, here's the policy that we've written. You implement it however it needs to get done. But we haven't had that conversation.
Well, we do know some of the costs because they relate mostly to personnel if in terms of if they become just a subsidiary like golf and like bowling exists right now. We have to have staff to manage that. So we do know some of those costs, and who's going to pay for that? Well, I guess, you know, you look at things that have universal appeal, like the bowling and like golf. Those are things that are so expensive and so, you know, used by a large number of people that there's no way a club could, you know, create a bowling alley on their own. So some of the criteria probably would be the cost and the generic appeal to a particular activity. But you're right, we don't have anything written that kind of says when that might happen. But we've also just recently had a budget meeting where people didn't want to pay an extra cent for their dues for any of these kinds of things. So, you know, that kind of gets in the way with things that we would like to offer without charging back to a particular organization or a group of people that are interested in doing something. So that's a whole piece of trying to figure out the policy. Jared?
So to that end, that's why I said we needed to have a cost analysis on any of these that we're looking at, because some of them would not apply, right, but others may, and there may be a way of doing that without us having to change a lot of the policy that we have already written. So all I'm asking is that we have a workshop to discuss what you just stated. Mm-hmm. You stated your opinion about it. I think others on the board have a different opinion. And I do believe under the subsidiary, there are specific things that you don't have to have as Mr. Schwinn having them be part of the staff, because I know that there's other organizations that do this. So again, why can't we look at the big picture overall and give him a policy so that we don't have different policies for different people?
Okay, so we have had meetings with all of these clubs, and we only have broadcast club that's still in question. We have a couple of clubs that are waiting for their 03 status. So the number of clubs that are not comfortable with where they're placed is pretty small, correct?
Yes, ma'am. You know, and again, meeting with these clubs, if there's a need, they're going to present that to us, and hopefully we can address whatever need that they have. But if I may just take like a half step back, when we talk about either subsidiaries or those types of things when it comes to clubs, keep in mind when we talk about bowling and we talk about golf, we, the Sun City Recreation Association, are a 501c4 organization. The golf courses are deeded pieces of property that we own, and we maintain those as a business, not a club. It's a business, as is the bowling alley. They're not clubs. We don't oversee clubs. All of the revenue coming in from golf comes into the association. All of those folks that work out there are our employees, and we charge fees for that to help offset the operational costs of those business ventures. So they're not club. There are clubs, 19 of them, associated with golf, but they are not affiliated really with us operating them. Those are independent groups, as are the 97 other clubs mentioned. Bowling and golf are opportunities that we present and we offer, as we own those. So it's a little bit, it's not really apples and apples here. So when we talk about subsidiary type stuff, I'm a little bit taken back, but we can certainly, mm-hmm. we have a committee, we have a club, charter club committee, we can certainly address anything, make a recommendation and come forward back to the governing board.
Yeah, one of the key things that happens is that the club needs to dissolve. And our clubs are not interested in doing that. They want their separate entity. If they were to come with us, then they're no longer the club. And they no longer have the president, et cetera. Anne?
Thank you, President Fitzsimons. Thank you, Bill, for your presentation. I also thank Donna and the Charter Club and committee and Casey for all their hard work on this. Couple of issues on subsidiaries. I think if somebody wants to be a subsidiary, that should come from them. I'm hearing one person, Sharon's the only one I've heard bring this up, that we need subsidiaries. I think that should be a groundswell. That's an operations, that's not governance. If someone wants to be a subsidiary and brings forth that information, which I think should come through charter clubs, then we can address it as governance. That's the way I would see it happening. And as for the broadcast club, I certainly don't want to see them go away. We may need to make some asterisk amendments or modification of the RRNPs for them. But again, I think that needs to come from that charter club coming to us and saying, this is what we want. We're not going to force them out of business in the next few months. Not at all. But I think that needs to come from them. We've just had a master plan survey. We've heard what people want. And we also heard that people don't want to pay for a lot of things. So we're going to need to focus on things that people have said they want and try to do the best we can for them with the money that we do have. Thank you.
Any other comments from the board? Lisa?
Thank you, President Fitzsimons. To Anne's statement, this is not just coming from Sharon, but I was approached by two craft club presidents who have been in the audience for meetings going back for 3-4 months, back into as far back as April 2021, when Bill was addressing the residents, as far as when this whole thing broke with the village store. And I think at that point, I think I was still on BNF with Ann. And so we were like, oh my gosh, what is happening here? Here lately, the question was, they met with their liaisons from the charter clubs. So in April, when I was sitting at the charter club meeting, listening to the liaison speak and everybody commending each other about how happy all the clubs were and all the club presidents, I was sitting near one of the club presidents, and she was appalled to hear her liaison say, oh, I've met with all of my people that were on my list. They were all extremely happy. She sat there dumbfounded because she had an hour and a half long meeting with her liaison. And she said they left that meeting, and it was not a happy meeting by any stretch of the imagination. So she said, I don't understand why they think it went well and we're not happy. But so they felt that they don't have a voice. What happened happened, and it's all done, it's over, and this is what they have to do. So everybody's saying all the clubs are happy, everybody's happy, when in fact, and we weren't at any of those liaison meetings, so we can't say anything. We just get to listen to what these presidents are saying.
Ann?
Lisa, thank you for clearing that up, but is this a club that wants to be a subsidiary?
They're not, they would like to know what they should do, because they don't know how they would go about what their answer is, because they've not been given an alternative.
Okay.
We haven't given them any, we've just told them, they're liaisons. I'm not saying we, because we are not involved, because that's operations, and we stay out of that. But they haven't been given any other direction. So I found it quite interesting just sitting in the back, and I think, Bill, if I'm not mistaken, was that the Charter Club meeting you and I were sitting next to each other, the April Charter Club meeting?
Could have been.
I think.
Which club are we talking about?
Well, I don't think I, at this point, I'm happy to share with you in private, but I don't feel like I want to throw anybody under the bus. She's not, if she were here today, I would probably say, but she's not.
Okay.
My suggestion is that they should come back and talk to operations about charter clubs, or go back and talk with Casey about them being dissatisfied. And, you know, there is a board, not just one president. So I wonder.
Back to committee.
Yeah, back to the committee. Absolutely. Tim?
Everybody has lost their keys, right? What do? You go look to find your keys. When you find your keys, what do? You quit looking. So the question is the solution that they have come up with, does it work? Yes or no? If it works, that's good. There's an old adage called Occam's razor, and that is, the simplest solution is usually the best. And I think he's found a good simple solution, and I think that that this discussion has gone on way too long.
Okay. Anybody? Harry?
Yes, there's a couple issues I'd like to address. First of all, when it comes to the C4, I have asked questions about it, and I asked to talk to the attorney in January, which I have never heard about since. And the second thing is the statement that everybody didn't want to pay their dues. Well, there are some certain people that didn't want an increase in dues, but I think a bigger problem was we are a not-for-profit organization that showed a $3.6 million profit at the bottom line, and that creates a bigger problem than a dues increase. Thank you.
Okay, any comments from the audience? Okay, this has been a discussion, as our workshops do not involve any kind of voting. So I thank you for all of your input, and we'll be thinking about what kind of direction we'll be taking, and we'll be hearing from decisions about the broadcast club and anybody else that's in limbo as that kind of thing progresses. Okay, the next item on the agenda is further discussion on the code of conduct. We started talking about this several meetings ago, and this is a work in progress where we're getting ideas from the governing board as to what kind of things. Excuse me. Okay, we ask that the audience can be quiet so that we can conduct our business up here. The code of conduct issue is something that we're talking about. As you know, we found ourselves in a situation last summer that we went to a recall election, and some of the reasons for discussing the code of conduct is to have some kind of intermediate steps so that we don't have to go to that degree that we ended up in. So that's kind of how all of this started, and I'm going to turn this over to Tim for the discussion.
Thank you, President Fitzsimmons. This was presented several months ago at several workshops ago, and the intent of this was to provide some sort of mechanism for the board to deal with itself. And since that time, this has been on the agenda several times, and other than one or two people, I've received very little feedback from the rest of the board on this. And the intent is that I felt that this board in particular, because we do have almost an even split of differing opinions, if this board could come to an agreement on what one side felt was responsible and what the other side felt was responsible, that we could move forward with some sort of code of conduct. And again, there's been several comments made at several of the meetings about how the board bickers and the board doesn't get along and all that sort of thing. And basically this was to set forth an agreement among the board members on here's how we were going to act, okay? And the converse of that side was some sort of mechanism that if people were disruptive or people were working against the board, that there would be some way to deal with those people, okay? And I think I've been pretty straightforward in saying that this is not something that's going to be used to silence somebody. It's not going to be used to retaliate against someone who has a difference of opinion. But I do think that it is important that we have some way of dealing with each other on the board in some sort of manner that everybody understands what our actions are expected to be, and everybody understands that if people go off the reservation, there's going to be consequences. So I would just like to poll the rest of the directors and ask them if they have any comments on this. Roberta.
It still bothers me under the disciplinary process that it goes to the board president first. Mm-hmm. I think it should go to the board officers.
Okay.
Only because if the board president has a prejudice against a certain member, then it's in their hands and it should be more than one person.
Okay, point well taken. It's not one person on one person. Okay. Anne?
Well, I also think if the discipline process should get to something that's very contentious and might include the president and or other members of the executive team, that we might get to a point where it would need to have a mediator might be a good word for it, or a committee, a group of people who are not on the board but are familiar with Sun City West, who mm-hmm. might be seen as bipartisan people, mm-hmm. for lack of a better term.
And how would we choose these people?
I don't know, and I hope it would never get to that.
We could have our own sitting.
But I don't think we'd want to have a. I don't think we'd want to have a group on standby, because hopefully it's not going to get mm-hmm. to that. But I think we need to think about those kind of things. The better thing would be to keep it from ever happening.
Mm-hmm.
Playing nice in the sandbox would go a long way. But
right.
Anyway, that's my thought.
Somebody had their hand up, Lisa?
Thank you, Tim. When you and I spoke the last time, and I did try calling you, but I couldn't even get your voicemail, so. I'm going to just stand by what I said originally when we spoke about this. And I agree with both Roberta and Anne in their comments. And I would like to table this into the new board when it's seated and we have the new slate of officers coming in. And I think we will see a new, much more cohesive environment. And I would like to see how the new board works before we start throwing this just right into play.
Okay.
That's just my opinion.
Harry?
I am one that has talked to Tim,
mm-hmm.
and I told him my feelings. And but I'm not also one that just says no. I tried to think up a solution, and that's what Tim asked me to do. And this is along with what Ann said. I think if we go this way, because I don't think the president or even the executive committee, because they can be all of one group, and it would lead to just more dissension within the, and create more dissension, that if you want to still put something like this in, it is the community that elected us. And that if we're going to do this, we have a committee of three of the residents that would hear all of this. No attorneys involved anywhere. If you get an attorney, you admitted your guilt. And this group is elected by the board, and it takes 6 votes to put a citizen on that committee. So it's going to be a pretty strong vote of the board that says who should be on that committee, and we would all feel very comfortable with those people, and they would be the ones to make the decision.
So would you see the board doing that before something happens or after something happens, or?
Before something happens. Okay. That's one of the first things in September 1 that the board would meet and do. And that's the only thing they'd meet and do. The people of the community would apply. Everybody would see their applications. If maybe they could reach a consensus of 4 or 5 people they'd like to talk to, mm-hmm. have the meeting. If they can get the 6 votes, it's done.
That's got merit. Thank you, Harry. Sharon?
Okay, to Roberta's point, on January 15th of 2021, I had a previous president send out an email to all of the board in regards to me personally, and with about 18 different things on it. And Director Davidson was the only person who stood up for me. So if you're going to do something like this, and again, we never had this meeting because Roberta and I both just said we wouldn't come. But again, this is not something that you should just arbitrarily say it's going to take 6 directors to take somebody off their committees, or because you can have one person that's not okay with a person on the board, and this would be the result. So I just think we have to be very careful. Del Webb did not put this into our bylaws for a purpose. The reason it's not there is because he doesn't want necessarily people to be removed from things by a group of people that are in the community. You got elected, you should be serving. And I don't think that we should be necessarily making decisions about who it can and can't stay on committees.
Wow. First of all, I hesitate to say what Del Webb's intention on this was. I'm sure in Del Webb's time, people were more amicable, and this probably never even came up. The second thing is, if you're talking about committee chairmanships and things like that, those are board, the president of the board decision with the advice and consent of the board, those are those positions. And that has been used in the past to remove somebody who was off the reservation, so to speak. The residents obviously have the final word in reprimanding or bringing somebody up for discipline, and that is the recall process. And we've seen that in a recent past, and I think we've also seen how disruptive that can be. So, good ideas. I'd like to hear from Jim as to what his ideas are, because I know he had some objections in the past.
Well, I'm just sitting here thinking about my objections, and I don't think they've changed. And I think that until you sat in the president's chair trying to figure out how to get 9 people on the same page, you don't really understand what's going on. And it's not as easy as just saying we're going to pick 3 people and fix this problem, because it ain't going to get fixed if you can't talk about stuff as a group. So as the president initially sees conflict, and it comes to the president right away because they've got antenna up, they've got people feeding information constantly. So you hear all that stuff. So if the president acts on that and works through problems, it gets a lot easier. And I don't know. Sharon's point about not having it in the bylaws for a reason, I don't know if that really has merit either. I don't know, Tim, who knows what Del Webb's thinking, but I do know that as a board, we should have differing opinions, but we shouldn't fight about it. So how does that work in real life? It's not easy. It's messy. Democracy is messy and all that stuff. But I don't know that I would I'm not going to be here next year, so it's not. You folks are going to have to work this out yourself, but I don't know that I would oppose it, Tim. So I would probably vote for it. But I do think that Roberta's point, though, is that we can't rely on one person to make a decision that Ann Brown is out of line and needs to be censored. It needs to be a group of folks making a decision. Mm-hmm. And we elect the officers of the board. The board elects the officers. So if you can't trust your board, your officers of your board, then there's another problem. And uh-huh. those people, you only need five people to remove a board member, an officer from the board.
Uh-huh.
So there is power within the board if you get five votes. And we found that out recently. So I don't have a problem, but I do think it needs to be enlarged in who's looking at it and how what power that group is given to handle it.
Okay, do you want,
is that enough, Tim?
Yeah, just let me say.
Can you clarify that statement? Because I think it needs clarification.
It takes five people to remove an officer off the board. Right, yeah. Right. Yeah. The board cannot remove board members. That's up to the residents directly.
Do you want to see if Donna has? Donna?
Yeah,
has any,
sure.
Donna, do you have any words of wisdom you want to add?
I really don't have any words of wisdom. This whole situation is sad for me. I think that it's important as a governing board to be a team. And as a team, that means we need to respect each other's opinion and we need to communicate with each other individually, one-on-one. And respect is necessary. And we shouldn't have our problems brought forward at the workshop. If you've got a problem, you need to communicate one-on-one and have respect for each other. This whole thing just really makes me sad that we have to be in this situation. We are a team, and as a team, we need to work together for the community. Thank you. That's all.
Thank you, Donna. At least what I'm hearing is everybody agrees that we should all work together, right? Can we make some statements around that as a beginning and say, here's how the members of the board are going to act with respect to their board duties? Can we agree on that? Okay, from there, it seems to me that the animus on this is coming with the disciplinary process, okay? That people don't want to, there's a fear, and I understand that there's a fear that this could be used to suppress people or to retaliate against people. I understand that. So let's do this. When we go into next year, let's work on the front part of this policy of here's how we're gonna act, okay? And if we can come up with that, and if we can demonstrate to the owner members that the board agrees to act in a professional manner, okay, I think that's going to go a long way. And then down the line, as we see how things are, hopefully, Lisa, I hope what you're saying is true and that we won't have unpleasant disagreements. Just as Jim said, disagreements are the way you get to good policy. So contrary opinions, I'm not afraid of contrary opinions by any means. But it's how they're delivered and the manner in which, the tone in which that. So let's begin with, I'll rewrite the front part of this and submit it to everybody and we'll go from there.
And my suggestion would be that maybe with the, instead of being so specific with the punishments, mm-hmm. whatever, that you leave that more generic. And then if you have a group that's going to be making that decision,
mm-hmm.
then that they can have things to choose from. And maybe that's more palatable.
I did actually originally think about having owner members sit on our own little grand jury. But the whole idea is to keep this internal and to work out differences internally rather than washing our dirty laundry in front of everybody else. So I appreciate it, and thank you, everybody.
Sharon has another comment.
Just a comment in including the new board members to make sure that it went out to them as well.
Yes.
Okay. Any comments from the audience? Dick?
Dick Rhodes, 125790.
I am a newly elected board member, as you all know, and will be assuming my office on July the 1st. So I'll be sitting up there reviewing documents as you are right now. I've read this document that Tim prepared, and I read it when I was actually doing review of some financial policies, and I ran into this, and I thought, heck, we've got the document. We have the document on code of conduct. Then I saw that was the draft, and I was kind of deflated. So I think that we're talking about an elephant in the room here. What we're talking about is the board, and this is going to be difficult to hear. The board has embarrassed itself on multiple occasions. I don't think there's anybody in the room here or anybody that's listening would deny that. One of the primary comments that was made to me when I was getting signatures to run for the board was, holy mackerel, can't you do something about the decency on the board? That I heard over and over and over again. And I actually had people say, I'm going to vote for you because you're not one of them. Well, I don't know if that's true or not, but I am an independent thinker, and I'll make up my own mind, my own decision. This is a code of conduct. This isn't a document for reprisal. This isn't a document for punishment. There's graduated infractions, if that's what you want to call them. Everything from, if you've ever been a manager or if you're a parent, you know the first thing you do is you verbally tell somebody, no, that's not the way you do business. And we have demonstrated what is not the right way to do business. Everybody here can actually probably pick out a day. I think we're missing the boat if we kick the can down the road. And if we don't do something about this, I think we should do it and do it now. We may not have it perfect, but you know, it's something that we're making the right decision, going in the right direction. I think we're missing it if we don't do this and do something with it now, with some sense of affirmative action that we're going to take. You know, so we could have another outburst, you know, in the September meeting. And we say, oh my gosh, I wish we'd have had something here. You know, so don't miss the boat. This is the elephant in the room, folks. This is one of the things that we have to deal with. Okay? Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? Okay, we will have finished the discussion. We've got the information that you need, Tim, and we'll act accordingly. Okay, are there any generic?
No, it's about this. So will we have a new draft?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Board general comments? Any general comments that you haven't already made? Roberta?
First, I want to thank Carl and Russ for our beautiful monuments as you enter Sun City West.
Yes, thank you.
I received so many complaints about the one at Meeker when you just get into, because it was empty for so long. But they came up with a solution and it looks beautiful. Thank you.
Okay, Harry, anything? Harry? Lisa? Ann? Tim?
I do.
Jim?
Wednesday, I was at a birthday party at Lizard Acres at 4 o'clock. There was there had to be 100 people in the room. The band, the DJ started, there was people dancing. There was, the drinks were flowing, and we left about 6, and it was getting busier and busier. So it appears that it's working well, and it was a great atmosphere. It was fun. You couldn't hear what was being said. Which is not our normal sort of thing that we do around here. But it was fun. It was good.
So I was there too, only I must have missed you. I didn't get there till about 5:30. So we must have just crossed paths. Yeah, it was a great thing going on. People really love the place and looking forward to enjoying it.
It needs more space, though, Madam President.
Well, and it needs...
I already
was on the phone with the general manager saying they need chairs, they need tables, you know.
We need to knock out that wall.
They need food, they need... keep it going.
The original plan on that, by the way, one more thought. The original plan between you and I, as you and I talked about it, was to knock out the wall and overlooking the pool,
right,
which, according to our guys out there, back there in the back, said that's not going to work. So, but that would solve the problem and would be an extremely nice
right, atmosphere. Yep. I got questions about where are the windows and where's the deck? Lisa?
Thank you, President Simons. So I guess on that note, I will have a comment. I did not put into Chair Sports Pavilion. Like, Tim, I hope it's okay. I'm going to let the cat out of the bag early, I guess. But Tim did ask me to chair it, so I am going to come back and chair that committee again. So that is something we are going to look at because it is just continues to gain momentum, all the activities. And I know Barry and I, at my last meeting, we looked at going through May with all of the trivia, karaoke, and live music, and now we're planning to go through June, and he said in June we'll continue to look at July. He does have a couple of nights scheduled in July because it's just continues to gain momentum, so we'll continue with that.
Yeah, it's a great venue. Mm-hmm. Any comments from the audience? Okay, I will just remind you that our annual owner member meeting and our regular meeting will be held June 23rd, and that will be at Palm Ridge, hoping for a large crowd. If not, of course, it'll always be on YouTube. And then I will adjourn the meeting.